Special speaker today, and so today is our day. With humor, many of you noticed that our secretary sent out an old church email that we're having a Caribbean meal after service. She meant Caribbean, and we love to tease her when the very rare mistake goes out from her desk. For announcements, for the deacons, next Sunday, we meet at the following church in the Truth Seekers Sunday School Room, the one downstairs that has a few steps up. There will be a deacons meeting after church. And everyone is invited, and we truly hope you'll come and join us for the fellowship meal today. And you see that we are beginning the Lady Sherry Luncheons. In April, there is a sign-up, and we are taking candy donations for our Easter egg hunt, which typically brings about 100 community persons to the lower lawn. And that will involve, I say a heads up, of that week before, a team cleaning up the lower lawn, because it's full of twigs. And last year we got here and went wild, but we hadn't thought of all the winter stuff falling down. Any other announcements today? Yes.
I think this would come under announcements. I believe that we had Betty Hess's birthday this past week.
Into perspective in these moments together. We have come to renew our hearts and to focus on how to please you first in all that we say and do. We have come today to find guidance from you and to navigate the week that lays before us. It is our prayer that right now you would lay your hands on each of us, for we need you and we are looking to you for guidance, for love, and for power to live these days. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. And at this time, praise team is going to minister to us.
Oh, nuts. It's the last day of winter. I can't snow here anymore.
Did you get out this year?
Yeah, I did. So we praise the Lord. The first one, great and mighty is He. So we're ready to sing now. Okay.
We believe in the Holy Spirit.
Into the tomb. This includes how we treat our unborn, our newborn, to how we bury and even treat our dead. How we treat our children, how we treat teenagers, young adults, those middle-aged, and how we treat senior citizens. How we treat those with disabilities, those who are ill or chronically ill. How do we treat those who are dying? This includes persons of every race, every creed, and culture. This includes the value of human life, persons who produce a lot with their life, and those who do not produce something to give back. Wherever we have human beings, others will find a way to abuse those human beings. Human life and relationships are very messy and bloody. And that is a challenge for all of us. Human beings, scriptures say, are fallen and will tend and push towards evil of all kinds apart from the grace of God. The early writers said of Christianity, and they used this word in the original Greek, that Christianity is a scandal, and it will ultimately offend all of us. It is bringing the values of heaven to a fallen world. True Christianity will rock your world, my world, and always challenge the workings of our heart and attitudes. In scriptures, God says time and again that all human life is sacred and that all human life ultimately belongs to God. I need to read this, I need to say it, and my heart needs to hear it as much as all of you. Because in this culture, we get a very different message. We are not sacred in and of ourselves, but we have a sacredness because you and I originate from God. And God took the first step in creating persons. And some say every breath you and I breathe is a continuation of the breath of God that was breathed in Eden. One of the most precious gifts that God ever gives in this world is that of life and the flowering and creation of new life. Think of how you and I celebrate the birth of a new baby. And think about how we mourn the passing of a loved one, all pointing to the sanctity, the sacredness, and the value of every human life. Our goal today on Sanctity of Human Life Sunday is not to feel for one aspect of humanity for a few moments, or give a little pity to children, teenagers, and women who are caught in human trafficking, and then go away and forget it. Our purpose is that God puts light into our heart. And, starting with me, our purpose in worship is to re-examine all of our moral convictions and reawaken them in light of God's word. Because the world is always dragging us down, and the movement of our culture is always pulling us back. And actually, we all, me included, experience what's called spiritual drift. We're walking close with God and enjoying His presence. Three or four things get us angry, and we don't even feel like we're the same person. There is certainly spiritual drift. Francis Chan says, the human soul leaks. We're filled with God's purpose. 3 weeks later, we've just become nasty. So you see, I say that with a smile. The human soul, it somehow seems to leak. The pressures and the pleasures of life choke our thinking and feelings about important things. And there used to be signs in all the churches that would say, 7 days without prayer makes 1 week. W-E-A-K. Have any of you ever seen that sign? And many of you have. That would, but it's true. Day after day, you and I become annoyed and angry at the nasty things that other people do, and we slowly give in and lump everyone all together, and thus we begin this drift, this removal of our hearts from the real concerns of this world. And then we naturally place higher values on those we like or who are like us, and we begin to resent those different from us. These are human ways and tendencies. So we come to worship because God calls us back to rearrange our thoughts, to touch our hearts, and really to help us clear our minds to focus on the main thing. God calls us to this hour to take and to make it our responsibility to get involved in these very messy and bloody issues of the misuse and abuse of humanity. Every Sunday, God brings a challenge and a scandal into our hearts. God's goal is never, starting with me, to make us comfortable, but to motivate us to be useful. And that is the hope and dream and prayer of this morning. Look in your bulletin to unison scripture affirmation. These are a few scriptures I chose. And in a moment, we're just going to read them together in unison. And we will not read the scripture citations. We'll just read the text, and it goes over on the back. And this is starting with me as a reminder of God's will for humanity and the value of life. And I encourage you to speak out, read with volume, and feel God's heart in these passages. Again, we're not reading the verse citations, and we'll begin with before. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I consecrated you. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. For you formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you. When I was being made in secret, it was tricky woven in the depths of the earth. In his hand is the life of every living thing and the breath of all mankind. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God has prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Are not 5 sparrows sold for 2 pennies? And not one of them is forgotten before God. Why, even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not. You are more valuable than many sparrows. Behold, I have engraved you on the palms of my hands. Your walls are continually before me. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of God? Or are you not of your own? You were bought with a price. So glorify God in your body. What a privilege it is, and frankly, once a year, to focus solely on the power of God and his love for his creation and the value of creation. I want you to turn with me in your hymnals for in a moment, we are going to sing our prayer song, but first we're going to share our joys and concerns. Anyone have something to update on? A number of us are visiting Joe Affluie each week. He seems pretty much the same, and he appreciates the visits very much. So please remember him, and I encourage you, find the courage and just go visit him. It's not easy to go see a friend who's down, but it's so important, and if the weeks go by very long. Other prayer concerns? Yes, Bill.
I would like to remember Brett Swales. He had to go to the ER this week, and he developed RSV, and also he's dealing with heart issue. AFib is called. So let's remember.
Mm-hmm. Carol.
I'm seeing with gratitude that we have a new baby in our family, and she's healthy, and the mother's healthy, and they're home. And it's such an answer to prayer for that little family and what they went through a little more than a year ago. And she's beautiful. And it's wonderful.
Yeah. A long sought after child that God ultimately provided. Doug.
Yeah, you referenced Joe. Yvonne and I were visiting Joe this week, and he was speaking in sentences.
Ooh, wow.
And it was startled. A little difficult to understand, but I think all of us are aware that is an issue because of Joe's accent. But we could understand Joe, and we could have a very nice, limited, but a nice conversation with Joe. And I thought that progress is just remarkable.
Amen. Yes.
I would like a prayer for my oldest son. He got a hole in his big toe, and they can't get it healed, and they're going to cut it off on Wednesday.
And is that from diabetes?
Nope.
Okay. Doris's son will have an amputation. Yvonne.
I don't know if people locally have in the news that Amanda Hofford, who was killed in an accident, and her husband, Brett Hofford, they're from Ephrata, he's in critical condition, and they have four young children, so that whole family, extended family, needs our prayers. She was a nurse at Women's and Babies, and just a beautiful person from what I gather. Tragic accident, and she was killed, but he survived, but is in critical condition in the hospital in Pittsburgh.
All right. How sad. Turn with me in your red hymnal to number 489 as our introduction to prayer. We will sing this twice. Renew us and guide us for the living of these days. We praise you because we are always receiving from you. We think after the horrible flood that you promised seed time and harvest until you return. And some of our early flowers are pushing out of the soil, and tomorrow's the first day of spring of this year again. During the last 7 days, dear God, we sat and watched the third largest bank failure in American history. We are watching a study of human nature, a study of greed, of selfishness, and foolishness. We are also reminded of how many conservative Lancaster County Christians lost fortunes in pyramid schemes over the last 2 decades. We are reminded that apart from you, this world could collapse at any time. We pray for the healing of America. We pray your hand of stability and wisdom on those who guide our national treasury and finances. On this Sanctity of Human Life Sunday, we lift our hearts to you knowing that surrendering all life to you goes against all developing cultures. We're reminded what happened in the 1930s in Europe with National Socialism and how that played out in the treating of the vulnerable. We affirm this morning, according to your word, that all life belongs to you. We pray for those among us who are suffering. And we pray not only for Joe, but also for Reedy and her daughters who are with her this weekend. We thank you and joy for this new baby and the couple who waited so long for this new part of their family. We pray for this young family who lost their mother, and now the young children will look to the father and others to bring them up alone, for great healing and great provision to all of them. Finally, we take a moment of silence, and all of us lift one special concern to you for your help and your touch and your working. Thank you for hearing this concern. In the cases where we have prayed for others, may they sense in this hour your touch and movement and calling on them for whatever the need may be. And all these things we do pray in the precious name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. And now, before Corinne shares, we're going to sing hymn number 403, Open My Eyes.
Thank you.
to come and share, please.
Good morning, like you said, I'm Curry Green. I'm the Marketing and Communications Director for North Star Initiative. If any of you have not heard of North Star Initiative previously, we are a local nonprofit that owns and operates a harbor home for survivors of sex trafficking. So I'm excited to be here with you guys today and just share a little bit more about our mission and the work we're doing in the community and how you can get involved if you choose to. I do just want to start with saying that this is a very, very heavy topic that we're going to cover this morning, and there's some hard information, and I want to be respectful of that. I know some things we'll cover may be triggering to your emotions or your experiences, so my heart is to share today gently and respectfully of that, and also honestly, because this is where true change begins, when we open ourselves up to having conversations about it and educating ourselves so that we can properly go out and support survivors in the world. So, to get started and understand our nonprofit a little bit better, we first have to understand what human trafficking is. So, human trafficking is actually the fastest growing illegal crime in the world today, generating over $150 billion in profit. And $47 billion of that profit comes directly from developed nations like the United States. So it's a huge problem happening right here where we live. And it can be described as the criminal act of recruiting, harboring, transporting, providing, obtaining, patronizing, or soliciting of a person age 18 or older for labor and services. And it's a crime federally in all 50 states, which can be broken down into two main categories. The first being labor trafficking. So that's trafficking someone for physical, manual labor with little to no pay, often in very unethical working conditions. And the second is sex trafficking. Sex trafficking will be our main focus today, as that's what North Star Initiative is battling daily. So sex trafficking is the buying and selling of men, women, and children to perform sexual acts against their will. They are held captive by their owners, who use their body to make profit. Sex trafficking, described by one of the survivors in our organization, is modern-day slavery. Every day, girls like me are sold over and over and over again to make money for their trafficker. To my trafficker, I am not human, I am a product. I have no say in what happens to my life. My trafficker controls me. I belong to him, he owns me, and that's what it means to be trafficked. So there are a lot of social stigmas and misconceptions about trafficking, and who is involved and why they're involved. So today I just want to take the time to break that down for you so we can have a better picture of what's really happening. So, sex trafficking has three main people involved. We start with the buyer. So the buyer is the person who is creating the demand for sex trafficking. They're actively seeking to buy or participate in sexual activities. They are buying this from the trafficker. So our trafficker is the person who is fueling the buyer's addiction. They are filling the market with the sexual interactions and content from a victim. Our victim is then the person being exploited and exposed and sold for profit. So we're going to take a deeper look in each of these three main people. So first, the buyer. They are often, society pictures them as the person who is higher up in society with the money and the status and the power to purchase sex under the radar. Unfortunately, this is not true. That the buyer can actually be one in five people in this very room today. The internet age that we live in gives almost everyone access to pornography, meaning anyone with a questionable internet search history who has found themselves clicking on inappropriate websites or images is a buyer in today's world. Watching, clicking on, or paying for pornography is a direct route to sex sex trafficking. So that means that it's really important for us to understand the terrible pornography consumption in our world today. And in order to battle buyers, we need to battle that consumption. So it's really important to understand that it's not some person that we're never going to have contact with, but it actually could be someone that you're interacting with daily. So then we jump into the trafficker. Again, society really paints the picture of the trafficker being someone who uses force. They kidnap their victims in dark alleys or parking lots. That's kind of our main picture of them. When in reality, most commonly, it is someone we know. It is our next door neighbors, family members, or even significant others who know, befriend, and groom their victims right under our noses. They use force, fraud, and coercion to control the lives of their victims, luring them in with the promise of security and love and adventure. So in order to fight back against the traffickers, we need to understand that they're not always easy to identify. That we need to teach our children and those around us to be aware of their surroundings, not only in public places, but also aware of their surroundings in close relationships, teaching them what it looks like to have healthy relationships, and especially teaching them to be aware of their surroundings online. Who are they interacting with on social media and the internet is so important to fighting back against the trafficker. So then that brings us to the victim. Society leads us to believe that the victim is often synonymous with prostitute, making us believe that this is a woman who is actively choosing this lifestyle, that she is purposely selling herself on the street. However, it is vulnerable groups like minorities, LGBTQ+, youth in foster care, homeless people, that they're vulnerable to this, and they're not actively setting out for this lifestyle, but it is these vulnerabilities and factors like poverty or low self-esteem or history of abuse that allows them to find themselves trapped in this lifestyle. So it's really important that we understand that the victim is not choosing this life, even if it may look like that from the outside, and that's how we can best support them. So now, once we kind of understand the three main people involved, one of our most asked questions is, why don't victims just run away, right? If they're in this terrible life and we understand all the bad things that are happening to them, why wouldn't they try to escape? So there's normally two main reasons why a victim can't just run away. The first being that they might not even know that they're being trafficked. And the other one being that they can't get out on their own. So that probably sounds a little weird that they wouldn't even know that they are being trafficked, but we've had many survivors come through our organization saying they didn't even know that there was a word for what was happening to them until after they were rescued and someone explained it to them. So that can be because they're too young to understand. The average age of a child exploited through sex trafficking is 15 years old. Or it could be because they were trafficked by a family member. So 48% of the victims who come through our program were actually trafficked by a family member. So if you're young, if a family member, someone who you trust, who is supposed to protect you, is telling you that this lifestyle is okay and that it's normal, chances are you're going to believe them. So a lot of them don't even know that there is a way out because they think this is normal. Or, like I said before, they can't get out on their own. So that normally has to do with a lot of society being undereducated and underprepared to see a victim's call for help. So that leaves a lot of victims going unidentified. So we just don't even see that it's happening around us. So no one's there to help them. Or they go misidentified. So a lot of times a survivor will be arrested, maybe is battling addiction or pregnancy or some type of health concern that they might be hospitalized or put in rehab or arrested and treated for that problem and then sent back out when we're not treating the root cause, which is trafficking. So they are misidentified and essentially not helped for the true thing that they are battling. So now that we understand a little bit more that what it looks like and how it's happening, people are often like, okay, thank you for this information, and I'll use it when I go to a big city or when I travel to a new country. But it's not happening here, right? Wrong. Pennsylvania is actually considered a pass-through state, and our close proximity to big metropolitan areas like Philly and Pittsburgh and New York and Baltimore makes our state perfect for trafficking because it is so easy to transport victims across county lines or state borders. So it is happening here. It is happening especially in Lancaster County with our influx of tourism through different seasons. So it's very important that we're aware of it. And our state report card for human trafficking this year was actually graded a D, meaning we have a lot of work left to be done. A D is terrible overall. So there's a lot of things that left to be done to move us up, hopefully, in the coming years. So how can you individually fight back against human trafficking? So first is to know the signs, which all of this information will be provided at our table, so I don't feel like you need to memorize it all right now, but knowing the signs, so some of the signs would be seeing someone who is inappropriately dressed for the seasons or weather, or maybe you see someone who they can't speak or move without someone else speaking for them. They have no kind of control over their own identity. Maybe you see someone who has no access to their own ID or money. That's a top one. Then it's to ask the questions. So if you do happen to see a victim and you, by chance, are able to speak with them alone, asking questions like, what do you do for work? Or does your family know where you are? May help you get a little bit more insight as to what's going on. And then it's important to make the call. So you can contact the PA Human Trafficking Tip Line or the National Human Trafficking Resource Center. Both are willing to help you and take all of your information down. So the best rule is just if you see something, say something. So you might not know for sure that it's trafficking, but when you make the call, experts will be able to take it from there. So it's not on you to figure out if that's truly what's going on. So now that we understand a little bit more as to what human trafficking actually is, you might be wondering, okay, how is North Star battling this? So more into our organization, we have a mission that is advocating and supporting for women who are survivors of sex trafficking by providing physical, psychological, emotional, and spiritual care all through a Christ-centered focus. So we are kind of considered a middle-of-the-road care facility. So when a survivor is rescued, there's like 30-day initial care, like safe housing that they need as soon as they're rescued. Then there's like 6 to 12-month programs that's more focused on therapy and rehab and that type of situation. And then there's long-term care facilities or group housing or independent living situations. So we're right in the middle with a year-long program. We started because our founder, Jen Sensenig, was running normal errands on Route 30 when she noticed that a business looked suspicious. And she kept watching and she kept trying to figure out what was going on and later presented her findings to local law enforcement. And it turned out to be a trafficking ring. And it ultimately was taken down and arrests were made and victims were rescued. But she realized that for so many, rescue does not equal freedom. So just because they were rescued and they were, you know, free to go about living their lives, they weren't free because trafficking takes so much from you. They didn't have their own birth certificates. They didn't have their own ID. Many of them never finished schooling. They had no job experience. They had no housing. Often they had no support because many of them were trafficked by family members. So they were free, but then they had nowhere else to go and often end up back in the life and back being re-victimized. So she started a home. So the Harbor Home is North Star's main program, and where women can come for up to a year and they receive all of their basic needs are met, they go through therapy, and all that type of stuff. So, break that down a little bit more for you. We have four phases in our program. So first, obviously, victims have to be referred to us in some way. Every once in a while, we'll get a self-referral that a woman will apply to come, but most of the time it's law enforcement or medical professionals or other organizations that refer someone to our program. Once they're here, they spend a lot of time just getting adjusted, because many of them haven't experienced what it's like to have a safe house and clothing and food consistently. So that's a big adjustment, just to trust in us and to trust in the program that they're going to continue getting this. So that's a lot of their first 90 days is really just adjusting to the program. We have 24/7 care for them, so one of our amazing coaches is always on property and always available, just for their safety and their protection. And then move into phase two, which is beginning more individual and group therapy and really going through the programming and unpacking the trauma that they have experienced. Then, like I said, a lot of these women come in with no IDs, no birth certificates, no health care. So they really work with our advocates to get all of that set up and taken care of. They start, many have unmet medical needs, so they start going through that process. Then, any other medical or dental care. Then they move into phase three, which is learning life skills. So many of these women have never even cooked a meal on their own. They haven't done a load of laundry. All that type of stuff is really important to functioning daily on their own. So we really start trying to teach them all that type of stuff. They may have education or work-related goals. So a lot of our women are working towards earning their GED. Some have enrolled in college classes or tech programs. And then they begin working part-time, all within, you know, our structure, so that way, you know, we kind of ease them into it slowly. And then they move into phase four, which is implementing all of these daily life skills on their own, with, like, you know, the coach is still there to help, but they're able to do all this on their own. They're not working full-time, and they're saving for their next steps. So that might be group housing for some, or maybe an individual apartment. So kind of just saving and planning and finding out where's the right fit for them to go once they graduate. We're so honored to say that many of our survivors have graduated. Quite a few completed a tech program recently and are actually welders and are making a normal income and surviving and living on their own. But our program doesn't stop there. We do have an aftercare program. So just because they graduate, we still want them to know that they are loved and supported, and our program is still always here to help them. So sometimes that's just a phone call every once in a while to check in. Sometimes they meet for coffee or lunch, as well as our program does our best to still provide them with maybe any clothing or other items that maybe are too expensive yet while they're on their own. So we still try to help them in that way. So that's kind of our program, how it looks. And all throughout all of those stages, our main focus is demonstrating Christ's love all throughout each stage. Most of these women have so much trauma that a healthy relationship they just don't even know what it looks like. So that's one of our main goals, is just trying to demonstrate His love and showing them what it looks like to be in healthy relationships with their peers, with staff, and so on. So that's kind of the main goal all throughout, is really teaching that. And so our girls attend Bible studies, they go to church on Sundays, and, you know, being a Christian is never a requirement for our program, but it's just something that we hope that they actively see, that can maybe plant a seed in a few of their lives. So over the last year, our organization has grown and changed in a lot of ways. We hired a brand new executive director, Melinda Clark, who started at the end of January, so that's been a huge blessing, and she's already made a huge difference in our organization, so we're so thankful for that. As well as, we opened the doors to our brand new Survivor Center. So a little over a year ago, we learned that running all of our organizational and administrative tasks out of the same house that our survivors are living in was just not doable. We were running out of space and it was just too chaotic. So we opened a brand new building. The doors officially opened this January. We're so blessed that all of the money needed to build it was taken care of. So we're completely funded. And now our organization is able to move into that building. We're able to open more programming, expand our classes, hopefully hire more staff, and just continue to grow the program and best support the needs of the survivors. And that also allows the Harbor Home to return to its true purpose of just being a safe house, so that way our residents are free from distractions and they can just truly feel safe in their own home. We are still working on the last few touches of this building, so we're still working on opening our gym to implement healthier lifestyles for our women and just showing them, yeah, what it looks like to lead a healthy life, as well as opening our boutique. So we have a boutique on our property that just allows new residents to come in and get a complete wardrobe and new clothes and things that fit them, which is something that most victims haven't experienced. So that's a huge blessing. And those are our last two things to open for fully moved in. And now if you're interested in being involved with our organization in any way, here are just a couple of our top ways. The first is always prayer. We can use prayer warriors all the time for praying over our past and current and future residents, praying over our staff. If you want one really specific way to pray for us currently, that could be we're looking to hire a clinical director in the next few months, someone who can oversee all of our in-house therapy, so that's one of our main prayer requests. Then we have a decent amount of events throughout the year that you're all welcome to come to, our next being on April 14th. It's a panelist event, so people from all different spectrums of the human trafficking battlefield will come together to discuss our PA report card, why it's a D, and how we can move to a C, hopefully this coming year. So that's coming up April 14th, and we'd love to see you there for this time of education and advocacy. And lastly, you could volunteer. So we use volunteers in honestly any way you want to show up. So we have people who come seasonally to do yard work. We have people who love organizing and cleaning and help us just keep track of our incoming donations and put things away. We have people who love crafts and will come, and currently I think we have a knitting club going on. Someone's coming to teach the women how to knit. We have plenty of people who come and just make a meal. And just, yeah, we'll help teach one of their favorite dishes to the residents and then stay for dinner and enjoy that time of fellowship. Really, if you have any gifts that you